Hello everyone. Today is Friday, October 4th, and it is only 49 degrees Fahrenheit this morning, and it is raining. These videos were taken over the past week, and I wanted to share with you a yard walk, and we'll take a look at what is fading out and what's coming in and what is still providing resources for the honeybees right here in the northeastern United States in the state of Pennsylvania. The sunflowers, of course, are pretty much gone by, and that provides a fantastic resource for the wild bird population. And in particular, in my neck of the woods, the goldfinches are on them. So with these going away, the asters are about at the last third of their use. It's time for the honeybees to really start to button down their colonies and their hives and seal things up and get ready for the cold. The asters here are still out there, but you know what? They provide very little resources. There is a native bee on that one there. And the asters come in a variety of colors, of course. The goldenrod is basically spent. There's nothing left there. You can also tell what the resources are by how long things spend on them. And of course, this year, we have an abundance of rabbits. This is a cottontail, northern cottontail rabbit. And since it was here, I just decided to go ahead and get some video of it. Doesn't quite know what to think of me or why I'm out here. And of course, hawks and fox are hunting the rabbits right now to get themselves through winter as well. Now, the sunset is fantastic, so I had to stop and look at that because some of the sequences I'm shooting, the camera equipment I'm using is very good, so it makes it look like it's actually earlier in the day than it is, but you'll notice there's a lack of contrast in a lot of the video sequences that I'm shooting, and that's because it is at sunset or later. So here we go. Here's a bumblebee. The bumblebees are on every kind of flower there is. They do not practice floral constancy like the honeybees do. So the honeybee jumps from these Maximilian sunflowers to asters to clover to everything else on a single trip. Now this is a honeybee doing her best to collect as much pollen as she can off of this Maximilian sunflower. Here's the thing about the Maximilians. Their pollen is very sticky. So it's not like some other floral resources where the bee just lands on it and the pollen sticks to their hairs and then they just groom it back. You can see how much effort this bee is spending trying to groom pollen. With the forelimbs there, and then she wants to move them back to the middle legs, and then, of course, the hind legs, where the pollen packs are located on the hind legs, specially designed just to hold pollen. And you'll notice it's windy. This is not a great time of year. As we know, the bees navigate by sun, so these overcast days or these darker moments when bees are caught out and about are harder on them. Some of the honeybees end up on the flowers overnight because it just gets too dark too soon, or a rainstorm comes in and they'll just cling to the petals of the flowers and stay there. You'll also notice that the bees really can't groom every inch of their thorax. So I've had lots of questions this year about white stripes or light colored stripes going down the center of the thorax of the honeybee. And what that really is just a very fine sticky pollen that attaches itself, and it's kind of hourglass shaped because the bee's legs don't reach to the very center. So they depend on the other bees once they get back to the colony. It is not a disease. It is just very tightly packed fine pollen. And here's a native bee, a native pollinator. This is called the leafcutter bee. I don't know if you've seen these before, but often different varieties of bees are mistaken for honeybees, and this is not a honeybee. All the bees are after nectar. They're all after resources. Not all of them use pollen, but like the leafcutter bee, it's going to cut some leaves, roll them into tubes, get into some rotted wood, maybe something that's been cleared out by a woodpecker, and these bees will lay their eggs and they'll winter over and hatch in spring. So there are a lot of bee species, by the way, more than the honeybees. Now here's what's going on. Things are intensifying. This is the time of year you really want your entrance reducers tightened up. If you don't have entrance reducers on your landing boards, your bees have a lot to defend. Look at that yellow jacket trying to get in on the left there. They're also fending off a scout bee from another colony that was trying to get in. If you get a strong colony that gets its scouts in there and they can actually get through the landing board guards, then you can expect a robbing run on the hive. So you may see on the front of a hive what looks like swarming, thousands of bees hovering around the entrance. But what really could be going on this time of year is a rob out. So all the hives, all the colonies are under pressure. All of them need to have entrance reducers on, and the guard bee numbers will be increased, just like on this landing board here. A disproportionate number of the bees on the landing board are there to guard. Some are venting, of course, because we still have nectar coming in. We do not collect honey resources from any of the hives this time of year, and that's because what they're bringing in now is going to sustain them through winter. In an upcoming video, I'm going to show you how I prepare the flow hives for winter, and we get those flow supers off and let those get cleaned up. Now this is all grainy looking because this is way after dark. You can tell by the sounds of the night insects as well. I also want you to notice that the landing board here, this was the colony that was consistently attacked by a skunk early on, and its muddy footprints were all over the landing board, but I want you to notice these landing boards are nice and clean. The skunks no longer attack the landing board, so I'm going to show you that at the very end of the video, starting at about the 10 minute 30 second mark if you want to see those night sequences. But the bees are going to be attacked more and more by yellow jackets. The pressure is going to increase. There's going to be lots of landing board fights. Some people like to put out yellow jacket traps this time of year. That does help decompress things, but the threat is equal from stronger colonies of bees. And this was one of my late season swarms. These guys are doing fantastic. They're defending themselves well. This is a flow hive too. Notice the flow hive entrances have a different configuration, so a standard entrance reducer doesn't work. That's why I just roll up window screen, and you'll see that that's camera left there. We close it up with window screen so that they can still vent it, but not have to defend it. And these are the goldfinches that I mentioned earlier that are definitely benefiting from all that pollination that the bees did on the sunflowers through the summer. And now nothing's going to go to waste because the bees are all over this meadow. Also, my feeders are basically not being visited at all because they planted so many sunflowers in the fields, and the birds prefer to go and get them from the plant themselves rather than a feeder, which is fine with me. There we go. This is another honeybee. Now, that's another question that came up. People were looking at my landing boards and saying, wow, Fred, are those bees from different colonies? Some of them are really dark, like this one here. Notice how dark the abdomen is. While others are kind of golden colored. What's going on? Are those from other colonies? No, you need to recall that when a queen does her mating flights plural, often she'll fly out and mate with 15 drones, even more. Some claim that a queen may mate with up to 20. So what we really have in a colony are a bunch of half-sisters. And of course, there are those within the colony that would be 100%, those that are from the same queen and from the same drone will all look alike. But different drones may have mated with a queen, and that results in a mixed batch of different colors of bees, and you see that on the landing board. You see it when you open the hive. Now this is a mud dauber wasp. These things are cool. One of the things I like about it, and remember, wasp bees, they're all after nectar this time of year. They're just trying to survive. Queens are hatching, and the queens are what are going to have to survive through winter. But a mud dauber wasp will actually land in a spider web and twitch around as if trapped. When the spider comes out to wrap her up, she grabs the spider and flies away. I'd love to get that video someday. And of course, here's a honeybee. She's got some pollen on her hind legs there, so she's doing a great job. And I cannot stress enough how fantastic these Maximilian sunflowers have been for my bees. They are coming in while the asters, goldenrod, everything else is fading out. Sunflowers, the standard sunflowers, are gone. And these are, of course, all their blooms are open, so there's nothing left after this. So once these close up, that's going to be it. And look at the difference in the color of this bee as compared to the one that just departed. So honeybees may be different colors from the same colony. Their genetics are mixed. So what we're going to see at the end, I want to show you how to keep predators away from your beehives at night. And it's been working, and I have several animal species to show you. So in the meantime, we're just enjoying these last bouts of sunshine. And of course, as of today, it's raining. So this sequence was shot earlier in the week. It's all raining, cold, 49 degrees. and we need to think about helping those bees button down for winter. Now we slow things down and we're going to go into the night mode, and I'm going to show you what my security cameras picked up, and it's a lot of fun. Also, if you want to see the audio ultrasonic devices that I'm using that are motion activated, solar powered, they will be in the video description. Here's a raccoon. Nice big plump one. Raccoons are notoriously curious. They get into everything and they don't often respond to deterrent flashing lights and things like that. But this one does not like the sound. These solar powered, they're shaped like owl heads, and I'll put a link, as I said, and you can see what that's about. And then of course here comes a big possum. And he doesn't like the sounds. Possums are very quiet and sneaky. And I'm underneath that tree, looking back, wondering what that noise was. So these motion-activated, solar-powered flashing lights, the lights aren't super bright, but the audio seems to bother all the animals. There's another raccoon cruising through in the background there. He does not come forward. The toughest rascals have been the skunks. We have several skunks out here. And the good news is they have not been very successful at coming back after the bees again. So putting in the solar-powered flashers, ultrasonic noisemakers definitely has kept the skunk off the landing boards. Here's another nice big possum walking through. Now, this is a collection of sequences that were collected again through the week and the shot all times of the night. And I'm using Arlo security cameras, which are just little magnetic cameras that you can put out in all weather, and they give a wireless feedback to your computer through a website, and you can check, you can even live check what's going on with your hives. Now I want you to notice here, look at how many bees are out on the front of these colonies. There are a lot of guard bees out there, and they're not putting up with any nonsense this time of year. They're stinging the skunk. He is not happy, and they're just coming after him, and there goes the skunk. So I'm sure you all feel terrible for that poor skunk that did not get to eat any bees. It did get some bee stings, and that skunk didn't show up again anywhere for several days. So the bees are angsty. Their defenses are up. Here comes a possum. Now, I don't know if I've ever seen a possum eat a bee. If you have, I'd love to hear about it. They definitely don't like the noises made by these ultrasonic systems, and it never came out and showed me the behavior that would show that they actually eat the bees. I think they're would-be insectivores. They would eat bugs if they found them on the ground. They're omnivores. But I have not seen one eat a bee, and that's okay with me. It shows that the alarms are working. And the lights, of course, come on. The LEDs come on with these Arlo camera systems. And they go dark, of course, when there's no motion detected. Now, that's a nice big raccoon, too. And it's interesting to be able to see what's out there. And raccoons tend to come back over and over again, get a little closer. They do not like the noise, though. Even though they seem to come closer and inspect, I have not gotten any video sequences of them doing anything to the beehives. So the systems are working. I have cameras pointing in every direction. And again, as I mentioned, I can live check in on these cameras, or they alert me when there's motion detected. And I can see what's out there. So it's great to have these sequences and look at things. And the batteries are lasting a very long time. I'm still reviewing the Arlos. But I can say early on that I like them a lot. And I'll leave a link to that too if you want to check them out. They're fantastic. So anyway, I hope your bees are doing great. Button them up. Get ready for those predator increases, and especially the wasps. And watch out for robbing bees. Thanks for watching. And I hope your bees are happy and healthy.